Right, I'm also joined by Alan Mendoza, the Executive Director of the Henry Jackson Society and Transatlantic Foreign Policy and National Security Think Tank. Alan, thank you for eventually joining us. I'm joking. So we're really looking at China now, because if sort of as an observer of it, it looks to me that like they may hold the key, because their association with Russia is such that if Russia starts to be a pain in the backside for them, they may start to take a different view and not be so, in a sense, collaborative with Russia.
Yeah, I think that's certainly correct to assume that the Chinese and the Russians have a relationship. That's clear, that's obvious. They were talking before this, they will continue to talk during and no doubt after. But you're right, there's a point at which the Chinese may decide it's more trouble than it's worth to be propping up Putin on his adventure. But I think that's not right now. Right now, they're actually very interested in seeing how this plays out, because it, if you like, it's game theory for their own moves in the future. And they look at this basically and go, right, Russia does this, here's a West response. Russia does that, that's a West response. Mm. So where do we, if we're doing the same thing, where would we do it differently, where would we not? And I think when you've got, if you like, a sandbox like that, the Russians being the puppeteer, it means that you can just let them play for a bit and until you call a halt.
Mm. And do you suspect that if we in the West decide, okay, do you know what, we're going to stop buying stuff and we're going to start sanctioning China now, that they could then have a big rethink and start to draw away from Russia?
Yes, I mean, I think that would not be in Beijing's calculations right now as being something worthwhile. Again, the question would have to be at what stage of any conflict it would be that this would happen, how, you know, who's winning, who's losing at that point, and crucially, of course, what the Chinese see, you know, as commercial gains as well in this. I mean, don't forget that the Russians are going to have to rely pretty heavily on the Chinese economically, and that's quite a big market.
Mm, but also, if we all decide to stop buying Russian gas, which we could do, if we really worked hard at it, it wouldn't be actually that difficult to find other sources of gas. Would China not then think, well, we'll buy it all off Russia?
Absolutely. Here's the irony of what the Russians have done. They've allowed themselves to, you know, Putin's going on about, oh, NATO's encroaching on me, etc. The West is encroaching on me. By this move, he is allowing China to encroach on Russia's power, on Russia's resources, and ultimately perhaps even on Russia's territory, because he has no choice but to deal with Russia as China, as the only viable alternative power who can bail him out. So he's leaving himself essentially at their mercy, which is a strange move for a so-called strong man to be doing.
Well, he might not see it like that. He thinks that he's strangling the West, but I suppose in doing that he's slightly taking his eye off the ball as to what the isolating position he's put himself in.
Mm. I think he didn't calculate this would be the result so quickly in the process, and that's probably
true. Do you think he wasn't thinking, because Russia is almost an island in a sense that he has backed up all the reserves, the currencies, he's stopped buying foreign currencies, he's got lots of gold, so he doesn't need to rely on any of the West, and he's also got a huge reserve of cash, and he's got the pipelines on Nord Stream 1, which I think that's the one that runs through Ukraine. Mm-hmm. He's got another one running through Belarus, and I can understand why tactically he wants those alliances and those countries. So where do they go next? And what's, in your eyes, where do you see this going?
What, the conflict itself? Mm. Look, it depends on, you know, how quickly he achieves whatever objectives he set himself in Ukraine. Were he to take the country, as it looked, the French believe that's his objective now. It seems, given his rambling speech yesterday, that might be his objective. Then, you know, what do you do after that? The country's going to be, you know, in turmoil. He'll have to pacify it. This is going to be bloody. At the same time, does this create, and does he have the troops to actually do it, is a big question. But let's assume he manages all that. Does he stop there, or does he take Moldova as an obvious next target? People haven't really spoken about this, but there's a long-standing Russian dispute in Transnistria. There's a potential to go, no, they're not a NATO member, not an EU member. It's tried to apply for the EU membership, of course. So you know, at this point, you look at this and go, well, he's likely to continue, isn't he, rather than stop, because at that point we'll have done X, Y, and Z sanctions to the extent we can do. So where does he go next? He goes, I've been sanctioned there. Unless they're going to militarily come against me, why don't I push on and see my next step? And I don't see ever in history a dictator going, fine, I've achieved this, I'm stopping there.
And I can imagine China will look onto that and say, well, look, if you affect our ability to make money, then we may act.
Well, they may act in it to Putin and say, yes, absolutely, you have now become an encumbrance round our neck. You've exhausted the possibilities of learning from this process that I was talking about in terms of what may happen to us. Now, it's only downside from here on. At that point, the Chinese may decide to play games the other way and try and restore their good graces. But let's not forget that Beijing has its own objectives here, and one of them is certainly not to look after the people of Ukraine.
Interesting stuff. Alan Mendoza, thank you very much for joining me. Very interesting stuff. He's the executive director of the Henry Jackson Society.